The discovery came out of some basic science experiments that David Klenerman and I were doing with our co-workers.
So the major discovery was a way of sequencing DNA much faster than can be done conventionally.
And the Human Genome Project was in full swing at that point in time.
The work we did, starting at Imperial, devised a new way of synthesizing using simple chemical methods, very bright, emitting particles.
So Acorn RISC Machine is the original development that we did back in the early 80s.
And so by the mid-90s, there are only about three groups in the world making these materials on a routine basis, and we had our own approach.
The mechanism by which we developed this into a technology was through a startup company called Selexa.
I made approaches to a few companies and it was all a bit early for them. One or two of them are now behind us in the market.
We went in at a pre-concept stage. We hadn't done any experiments that showed our idea would work. On the other hand, everyone knew that if you had a way of sequencing genomes much faster, this was highly commercial.
And eventually, in the early years of this century, we decided to form our own company. Nanoco that we formed from Manchester.
It wasn't merely that Acorn was a small company, we were a tiny part of a small company doing this. We had to make it work first time.
I think personally it helps a lot to understand that the pull for the investor is the potential of a market. And they're not really interested in your company, they're interested in money.
With the help of folk at the Sanger, we were able to convince the investors that the question of market size in the future would be resolved by itself.
And so if you can point to a market like displays and say, you know, this could be in every house in every country in the world, then they start to look interested.
What we got was mostly people saying, I don't believe you've done that. If you could do something like that, we'd have heard of it. So not only had we done it, we'd kept it a secret as well.
Eventually, you get to the point where you get somebody to fund you. And so our first funding was £600,000. And then within about 18 months, we brought in £2 million.
Apple wanted to use ARM, and they liked it a lot. So between Acorn, Apple, and VLSI Technology, we span the ARM team out of Acorn to create an independent company.
Things in the UK fall into this gap where they need to go between what people call TRL levels. It's after it's been invented, but before it's been developed. And that's the trickiest part to get funded.
So now it's very widely used. I think most of the genomes that have been sequenced using our technology.
The ability to sequence large amounts of DNA quickly and accurately and affordably has spawned a number of other areas in the industry, notably informatics, data handling.
By the numbers, and the numbers are astonishingly large, something like 55 billion chips have now been shipped bearing arms.
As a scientist, you want to ultimately, in the long term or the short term, benefit society and the people who pay for your research.
If you have an idea, an invention, an observation, take the time to dream a little bit about how the world might be at some point in the future if you were to develop it in a certain way.
Practically everybody on the planet owns a device powered by an arm.
We have to respect this kind of achievement more, and I suppose the kind of event we're involved in is trying to engender that view and show that it's led to people becoming successful, and also in terms of changing the world a bit.
I mean, the worst thing that can happen is you can fail.
It's an overnight success that was 30 years in the making.